Hello, Henrik.
Hi. Hello, how are you?
Perfect. It's all working.
Good, good.
Great. Okay, so if you have... So, welcome everyone to the biomarker session. The chair and first speaker of the biomarker session is Professor Henrik Zetterberg, and who's been kind of someone I've collaborated with in previous studies. And I always have a feeling that if there's anything to do with biomarkers in Europe, Henrik Zetterberg's name is on it. So he's a professor of neurochemistry at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden and at University College London in the UK. His main research focus and clinical interests are fluid biomarkers for central nervous system disease, and has published more than 1,200 papers and received numerous awards. So today he's presenting an update on fluid biomarkers for TBI. Henrik, it's all with you now.
Thank you very much, Gus, and thanks for inviting me to this exciting session. You will hear from me, Ros Erik Thelin, and Niklas Marklund. And I will start to talk about, to give you an update on fluid biomarkers for TBI. We'll talk about research and potential clinical utility. And I could start with this obvious question, why would one want molecular biomarkers? One obvious use is to detect the injury to the brain following a head trauma, because it's not self-evident that the head injury will immediately impact the brain. And then biomarkers could help. Molecular biomarkers could also help to predict recovery time, and potentially they could be used as a return to play test. They could also be used as additional examinations in individuals with prolonged symptoms after a head trauma. Are these symptoms due to a CNS process or something else? If one starts with this slide, we have developed quite a number of targeted assays for proteins that are of relevance to brain trauma. To the right, upper right, you see synaptic markers like SNAP25. Then we have tau as an axonal marker, neurofilament light as another axonal marker. Phosphorylated tau is a biomarker for tangle pathology, but mostly the Alzheimer type of the tangle pathology. It doesn't work that well for tangle pathology in, for example, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, but that we can discuss more on later. The neural soma contains proteins like neuron-specific enolase. You see it both to the left here. SBPDs, that spectrin breakdown products, and UCHL1, which is also a very highly enriched protein in the neural soma. To the left, you see the dendritic tree of the neuron, and that can be marked by neurogranin. That's really a post-synaptic dendritic marker. Astrocytes and microglia secrete a lot of different proteins like S100B, GFAP, also some cytokines and interleukins, TREM2, ketotriosylase, MCP1, complement proteins can also be secreted. And the blood-brain barrier can be monitored with a simple CSF to serum albumin ratio. There are also some new data on CSF levels of soluble PDGF receptor beta, but that has not been examined in relation to TBI yet. Amyloid pathology, typical of Alzheimer's disease, can be monitored with by measuring different A-beta fragments. But after axonal injury, we have an upregulation of beta secretase cleaved APP and also other A-beta forms that can sometimes give rise to diffuse amyloid plaques close to where injuries have happened. There are a couple of other proteins that and pathologies that can build up in potentially secondary to neurotrauma, and that is TDP43 pathology and alpha-synuclein pathology in Lewy bodies. But here we have no really good biomarkers. In this presentation, I will focus on neurofilament light and tau, but I will mention a couple of other proteins also. So one of the first studies we did in the field of mild traumatic brain injury has been in boxing. Our original idea was to actually test if we could detect Alzheimer-related molecular processes in the brains of people who voluntarily exposed themselves to repeated brain injury. That was our first idea with this study. So we included 14 amateur boxers and 10 friends of those boxers, and we performed CSF sampling by lumbar puncture 7 to 10 days after the bout and after a resting period of 3 months. 7 to 10 days after the bout was chosen very deliberately on the basis of what we knew about biomarker dynamics in lumbar CSF after stroke. The changes are slow in CSF, so a week after is rather optimal to detect changes. And this is what it looked like. Amateur boxers who took more than 15 hits to the head had clearly increased neurofilament light levels in their CSF. It was approximately half of those boxers having taking more than 15 hits to the head. After the summer rest, the levels normalized, but they were not completely normal if you compare to the control group here. Here are GFAP changes. GFAP is this astrocytic protein that is has an increased expression if you have astrogliosis and also astrocytic injury. So higher levels after bout and more normal levels after summer rest. And these are the tau changes. Both the tau and neurofilament light changes, in at least those boxers with the higher concentrations, those levels are definitely pathological. Those levels we typically see after smaller strokes or in about of multiple sclerosis or so. There was no evidence of Alzheimer's pathology in this group of rather young people, but people who exposed themselves to brain trauma. So phosphatidyl levels and A-beta 42 and 40 levels were normal in the lumbar CSF. Then we did it again because the Swedish Boxing Association thought there was something wrong with the first study, but the results were highly replicated. So neurofilament light high, really high in some boxers, especially those who took more hits to the head. And there were no evidence. There was no evidence of Alzheimer's pathology in this group of boxers either. Normal phosphatidyl and A-beta levels. This is a knockout boxer. The boxer had a knockout bout here, and then he came to us and asked for having his CSF examined, and then he didn't want to box until he had normalized in this injury marker. That was his way of dealing with his brain trauma. Here was tired of waiting for the levels to become normal, but that was not a real bout. He had to interrupt it in the first round because of a thumb injury. It took 8 months for the biomarker to normalize, so it is these are rather slow processes. We do not know if this prolonged increase in neurofilament light after a single knockout, if that is due to ongoing injury or if it's more due to Wallerian degeneration of as a response to axonal injury. That is probably the most likely, I would say. And that's a process where microglia are very active in engulfing the dislocated or disrupted part of the axon. Neurofilament light is, you already see it here, it is a dynamic marker. This is what it looks like in other, in this case, in multiple sclerosis in response to effective treatment. So to the left you see multiple sclerosis patients with their CSF neurofilament light levels before treatment, and in the middle you see after 6 to 12 months of treatment with natalizumab, which is an effective anti-MS drug. And you see that you treat the patients towards healthy control levels. And this works also in neurodegenerative disease. These are neurofilament light levels in children with spinal muscular atrophy who respond to an antisense oligonucleotide treatment. Very well, they survive thanks to this treatment, and then also neurofilament light levels normalize. So we think that neurofilament light has very interesting aspects as a biomarker for different injurious processes to the brain, and that the dynamics of the biomarker could potentially tell when the brain has recovered after an injury. Here are data from HIV infection. HIV rapidly establishes itself in the brain, and in the upper part you see this is data from a primary HIV infection. The ages and exact sampling dates are a little bit muddled here because or made up here because it shouldn't be possible to identify this individual. But this was a primary HIV infection. With the red line in the upper graph shows the RNA levels in plasma, the blue line shows the RNA levels in CSF. The green line shows the CD4 cell counts, which were normal from the start, but then dropped, and then treatment was initiated, and then the CD4 cell counts rapidly normalized. The RNA levels went down, and you can see in the lower part how neurofilament light crept up above the normal cut point and all the reference limits, and then in response to treatment normalized. Here it doesn't look that dramatic, but here is another case. This is the case with HIV. And low CD4 cell count at the time point of diagnosis, and high CSF neurofilament light levels from the start in the lower graph here, and then in response to treatment, the biomarker normalizes. This is HIV-associated dementia, very abnormal RNA levels in both CSF and plasma, very low CD4 cell counts, very high neurofilament light in the lower graph. Treatment is initiated, neurofilament light is normalizing, and with a small spike when treatment was interrupted around the patient age of 53 there, and then neurofilament light goes up again, but goes back to normal when treatment is reinitiated. So again, we think that this biomarker really reflects what is going on in the brain in response to injurious processes. This is the Swedish Ice Hockey League, and these are players who had post-concussive syndrome, and if you look here in the A panel, you see CSF neurofilament light levels in individuals with post-concussive syndrome and controls, no difference at all. But in the D panel, you see if you divide the ice hockey players in those who have had symptoms for more than 1 year and those who have had symptoms for shorter than 1 year, you see that those with prolonged post-concussive syndrome, they have increased neurofilament light levels, very much up to the level you see in neurodegenerative diseases. And the question here is if this group actually has CTE, or at least some of them, but this is not known yet. There are no autopsy data, but this is we think that neurofilament light could be used as a biomarker to find individuals who have something which is going on in the brain, and potentially that could be CT, but that's not known. That will be a topic for future studies. For other biomarkers, we saw a small tendency towards lower Aβ42 concentrations in this very, very same group individuals with post-concussive syndrome for 1 year and longer. But again, it's not really significant, and it's not as low as one would expect if there is established amyloid pathology, but potentially there might be something wrong. The other biomarkers are pretty normal. Can this be measured in blood, one could ask? And we have worked a lot with neurofilament light and tried to make that a sensitive blood test. So we took the regular ELISA, the human diagnostics ELISA, we took the antibodies and the standard protein and put it on the single molecular platform, which is a digital ELISA with a digital signal capturing, and you can then get very nice analytical sensitivity. And you see that these blue triangles here, they show where you have measurable levels. And the green square here indicates what normal people often have in their blood of neurofilament light. This correlates with CSF, so we have a blood test that reflects the CSF levels. Here are data from severe traumatic brain injury, and on the x-axis you see days following the injury, and you see a massive release of neurofilament light into the bloodstream. And those who survived to a one-year follow-up, they are not normal, but at least they have approached normality a little bit as compared to what they had in the acute phase, but they are still higher than controls. So again, we have this type of prolonged injurious process going on, or brain process going on, if it's continued injury or just a cleaning up of injury that has happened, it's not completely known. Here you see the dynamics of neurofilament light in CSF in the A panel and in blood in the B panel. And this is something that we see in response to almost accidental human experimental neurotrauma, one could call it. This is a study we did together with Umeå researchers, where these researchers were putting in an intraventricular catheter to deliver the drug rituximab in progressive multiple sclerosis, and the hypothesis was that intrathecal delivery would work better for treating progressive multiple sclerosis. The treatment didn't work, but here you can see the spike in CSF neurofilament light levels in the A panel in CSF, and you see that that is replicated completely in the blood. And the maximum increase happens somewhere around 30 to 70 days after the injury. These are the same boxers that we studied in CSF that I started the presentation with. But these are the blood levels when we learned how to measure those. And you see that those with many hits to the head have increased levels in the A panel here. And so basically the CSF data are replicated. This is a study we did together with Las Vegas, a neurology clinic in Las Vegas, where Charlie Burnick is taking care of professional fighters, both retired and active fighters. And you see here in the A panel, boxers who have retired are not that increased in neurofilament light levels, but there is big spread of data, so some have ongoing neuronal problems, neurological problems. And then you see the active boxer group, they are much higher than the other ones, much higher than MMA fighters and also the controls. And for tau, we see a little bit of a different pattern, where the MMA fighters are the ones with the highest levels. But these changes are not very strong. If we look in the Swedish Ice Hockey League in response to acute concussion, we managed to sample 87 concussions, and we took samples 1 hour, 12 hours, 36 hours, and 144 hours after the injury, and then when they returned to playing, 6 to 10 days after the injury. And here you see the data. It's a messy graph, this A panel, but I think it reflects reality. So most of the concussed ice hockey players did not have release of neurofilament light into their bloodstream. Most were at their baseline, but around 10% take off in their neurofilament light concentration. And I think this is probably what happens in many concussions, that most concussions are not that, do not induce severe axonal injury, but some do, and those are the ones who take off in neurofilament light. We have tried to figure out if these concussions had more rotational injury or something else, but we have not been able to collect solid data on that. But this is where I sort of have a hope that a neurofilament light test at day 6 to 10 or something like that could be an objective measure of whether the concussed player could return or to play or continue to rest. But this is a hypothesis. It has to be studied in scientifically now. We have no strong data that this would be the correct approach. But this graph gives me hope that this could be potentially possible. Then we have the question in trauma. When should one take the sample if you want to detect the trauma? And we have done a number of studies that potentially could help addressing this. This is a study where we had repeated blood samplings during and after anesthesia and surgery. And neurofilament light levels look pretty stable. There is a slight increase over time. Tau looks like this. It increases during the first 6 to 10 hours after the onset of the surgery. So it has a rapid increase. And this is a study on cardiac surgery, on or off pump. And then you see that the group that where you had extracorporeal blood circulation through a heart and lung machine, an external pump, then you see this type of increase in the A panel of tau levels. And here that happens during the first day. These early time points are during the first day after the surgery. And the fifth time point is day 7. Neurofilament light, there you see the difference at day 7. So again, tau is faster and neurofilament light is much slower as a biomarker. And here one can also see similar things regarding a lot of other biomarkers. So this is a study. I think Erik Thelin might show more data on this, but you can see that for S100B in the A panel, NSE and GFAP, they are fast. The more increase, the more correlation with the high increase early in correlates with worse outcome. For UCHL1, tau, and neurofilament light, the patterns are different. For UCHL1 and tau, the patterns are also indicate that it's a rather early marker, whereas neurofilament light continues to increase after the trauma. And there are not that clear group differences here, but still it really shows that the dynamics of neurofilament light is very different from the other markers. And here is another study we did together with Finnish researchers, where we actually examined acute blood samples for GFAP and NFL concentrations, and both predict outcome actually already during the first 24 hours. An outcome in this case was complete recovery or incomplete recovery. So there is a lot of potential with these biomarkers. If we look at blood levels of neurofilament light in the ice hockey players, we again see this difference between players with post-concussive syndrome for more than 1 year as compared to players with post-concussive syndrome for less than 1 year. So, and again, we think that this, it's really identical to what we saw in the CSF. So again, we think we can use this biomarker in this type of study, a simple blood test indicating that something is going on in the brain in those with these types of prolonged symptoms. So if one was to conclude here, we have serum and plasma neurofilament light as a promising biomarker for neurodegeneration and or neural injury. It works both in chronic diseases and in acute conditions. Neurofilament light is a dynamic biomarker following brain injury. In acute TBI, the timing of the sampling is essential, and neurofilament light is then comparably slow and peaks several days to weeks post-injury. And more research is needed in regards to whether the slope of the increase or the maximum level is important to predict outcome. And also this idea with potentially using this as a return to play test. GFAP, tau, S100B, UCHL1 and NSE, they are more rapid. NSE and S100B have some problems with release from red blood cells and other extra cerebral brain tissues, but GFAP is actually a marker of quite some promise as an acute injury marker of the brain. For late symptoms, I think neurofilament light is at the moment the only blood biomarker with a clear signal. And as you know, and as you will hear in this session, there is a lot of research going on in this field. There are other biomarkers, there are saliva tests, there are plasma phospho-tau, there are microRNA profiles and exosome studies, and so a lot of things to watch and follow here. It's a very dynamic field. More, in all cases, more longitudinal studies are needed. Here's the team in Gothenburg, the lower part of the panel, and my London team in the upper part. And with this, I thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Fantastic. Thank you, Henrik. If it's okay, I'll be asking you some questions and taking them from the comments as well. If you have any questions, please do type them in the questions box. The first one is from Greg Scott. In your experience, is the NFL level a measure of the accumulated brain injury, or rather the rate of some ongoing injurious process? Is the area under the curve of NFL over time perhaps a better predictor of brain injury or total neuronal loss than a single reading or slope?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I do not know the answer, unfortunately. So the way we have reasoned regarding the fluid biomarkers in general is that they indicate what's going on in the brain. If you have an ongoing axonal injury and ongoing release from, for example, also in Wallerian degeneration from the distal part of the disconnected axon, you will have a continuous release of neurofilament light, and you will also have a continuous clearance. Most likely these processes are quite slow for neurofilament light, but still we know that within 3 to 6 months, if you stop an injurious process, the biomarker goes down. The brain will still have been injured. So if one would have looked at the level at the month 3 to 6, then one wouldn't be able to stage the injury in that patient. That, I think, there we need imaging. So I think they are complementary. But this idea with integrating the area under the curve of with a profile and check if that correlates with MRI evidence of tissue loss, for example. I think that would be super interesting. I also think the slope could indicate the intensity of something, and then of course also the how if the biomarker does not go down as expected within 3 to 6 months, then I think clearly there is something that is continuing to go on in the brain tissue.
Fantastic. And a further point to that one from Greg was, are you seeing NfL working as a marker of treatment effects? Is NfL going up or down? For example, instigating immune treatments in neuroinflammatory disease?
Yeah, so levels should go down of neurofilamentite. It's definitely not this type of biomarker that might go up in response to a regenerative process. It should go down. There's been a lot of discussion regarding this in Huntington, because in ASO treatment of Huntington, NfL levels went up acutely, and that correlated with increased ventricular volume. Then the levels normalized after a while, but they really never went down in the clearest way. So, and here there was a lot of discussion on whether this increase could reflect some kind of regeneration, but all data indicates that it is the opposite. So levels should go down.
Fantastic. I have another question here from Edel Helmy. You mentioned NfL sampling at 7 days to allow return to play. Mm-hmm. How would you design the study? What is the outcome metric you would use to show safety?
Yeah, this is such a... I do not know. It's almost like one would need to do a big naturalistic study where you would just follow the general recommendations, but include a sampling time point at day 6 to 10. But otherwise, you would allow the players to... you would use your normal setup to take decisions with the player on whether or not to return. And then I would need to follow this over a couple of years and then check if there is if there are more problems in the group, the subgroup, with increased levels at that 6 to 10 days time point. But that's one way of designing such a study. Of course, it will be expensive and hard and very noisy. But I can't come up with any other good design, actually. So it's not an easy study to do. I think we would need to get together and collaborate on this.
And last one, I'm going to give you this last question and the remaining questions for you, Henrik. Perhaps at the end of the session, I could bring you and point you back towards these questions that we can then record. So the last question here I'm going to take is from Cornelius. Would you mind further commenting on the connection between blood-brain barrier disruption and blood biomarker levels? Is there data available?
Yeah, there are some data. I think that if you look at the very early increases in tau, S100B, and NSE, one interpretation of those, you know, increases that might happen in the blood 1 to 2 hours after the injury is that this is transient blood-brain barrier opening, where CSF or interstitial fluid levels of these proteins leak out. It's not like they leak out from the axons and the cells, but they are already present at higher concentrations in this interstitial fluid, and then they come out in the blood and you get this spike in this. So I think actually that those early increases that I showed rapidly in one of the slides might actually reflect transient blood-brain barrier opening, and that a frank neural injury is what you see days after. But that is also a little bit of a hypothesis. And what one would need to do is, I think, an animal study where you label animals with isotope-labeled amino acids or something like that, and look at if, and then induce an injury, and then you measure in the blood with mass spec and check if it's old or newly synthesized proteins that leak out. And my hypothesis would be that these are the old proteins that already exist in the fluid surrounding the neurons, in the extracellular matrix. But that's how I have come to interpret these early changes, transient blood-brain barrier opening.